Today we're going to talk about hip pain, hip impingement, and hip injections. I've got a pelvis, a magic quarter, and a box of something to help us unpack the myths and the mysteries and the realities around femoroacetabular impingement and hip injections.
Why are we talking about hip injections?
Hip injections are something that surgeons use to determine whether or not somebody with hip pain will benefit from getting a hip surgery to fix their allegedly bad bone shapes.
Why did you say allegedly bad?
As we've covered in previous videos and in an in-depth article that I will link to in the description box, there is no scientifically documented link between the FAI bone shapes and actual hip pain or range of motion problems. So I say allegedly bad bone shapes because there is still no evidence that those bad bone shapes mean anything. All signs point to those bone deformities being just normal, natural anatomic variations. Leaving all that aside, doctors say that if they use an anesthetic and inject it directly into your hip joint and you get relief, it shows that you actually have a problem in the hip joint that needs to be surgically corrected.
How do they know that?
Medical faith in using hip injections as a diagnostic tool is based on a 2004 paper. I'm going to link to the paper in the description box so you can check it out for yourself. The paper claimed that hip injections are 90% accurate in detecting deformity or damage in hips. But if we look closely at this paper, we'll see there are all kinds of problems that make its conclusions highly suspect.
Is this like that movie with Kaiser Soze?
No, that's The Usual Suspects.
That was a good movie.
It's also not relevant to this discussion. First of all, this was a study done on only 40 patients. All 40 of these patients had hip pain and were seeking the care of a hip surgeon who was publishing this study. The theory was simple. If they did a hip injection and the patient got relief, it meant that there was some sort of hip joint damage that the surgeon would find and would need to repair during the surgery. This is the exact same thing doctors will tell patients with FAI. If we give you a hip injection and it relieves your hip pain, then it shows that we need to go in and fix your hip surgically. But when we look at this paper more closely, we see something really curious. In this study, 37 out of 40 patients got relief from their hip pain from the hip joint injection. During the surgery, only one patient was determined to have no hip joint deformity or damage by the surgeon. When the surgeon operated on the three patients who didn't get any relief from the hip joint injection, he determined that they did in fact have damage and deformity, and so in those cases, the hip joint injection was incorrect in its determination. So 4 incorrect answers out of a total of 40 gives you a score of 90% accuracy for hip joint injections. But that is not an accurate interpretation of what's going on here. In order to truly gauge the accuracy of the test, you need to ensure that the test can accurately identify negative cases as well. This study did not do that. All we learned from this study is that the hip joint injection is good at giving a positive result. Think about it this way. I have this box, and inside this box are 39 white shoes and one black shoe. I'm going to reach deep inside this box and grab just one shoe, not looking at it. Before I pull it out, I'm going to do a test with my magic quarter. This magic quarter will help me determine the color of the shoe that I'm holding.
Can I have that quarter when you're done?
What are you going to use it for?
Never mind.
Here's how the magic quarter works to tell me the color of the shoe that I'm holding. I'm going to drop it on the ground. If it makes a sound, then the shoe is white.
Wait a minute, that doesn't sound right.
Watch how this works. I've grabbed a shoe, I drop the quarter, it says it's white, I pull it out, and it's white. I reach inside, I grab another random shoe, I drop the quarter, it made a sound, and it's white. Because 39 out of 40 of these shoes is actually white, my magic quarter test is going to be right almost all the time. In this hip injection study, the surgeon determined that 39 out of 40 patients actually had hip joint deformity and damage. So as long as the hip joint injection gave a positive result the majority of the time, it was going to come up with a very accurate result. If we had used this magic quarter test to determine whether or not these 40 patients had hip joint deformity or damage, we actually would have gotten a higher accuracy score than with the anesthetic hip injection. Literally any made-up test that biases towards giving a positive result would have gotten a really high accuracy score. Because the surgeon determined that 39 out of 40 patients had hip joint damage or deformity, A bogus test that returns 100% positive would have been 97.5% accurate. And even if we took out two of the white shoes and put in two more black shoes, my magic quarter test still would read as 92.5% accurate. To really gauge the accuracy, you would have to have more true negatives. You'd have to have more people who clearly do not have hip joint deformity or damage. That's the only way you can test whether or not this hip anesthetic injection is actually accurate. But since the surgeon unsurprisingly determined that almost everybody needed surgery, we can't really know whether the anesthetic injection is actually accurate.
Can I have that quarter now?
No, I'll give it to you at the end of the video because first we need to talk about hip joint injections in another way. Orthopedic surgeons will often say that if they give you a hip joint injection and it relieves your pain, it's a good indicator that the surgery will be successful and will relieve your pain. In a 2014 study, researchers did look at this exact claim. Quoting directly from the abstract, a positive response from an intra-articular hip injection is not a strong predictor of short-term functional outcomes following arthroscopic management of FAI. In other words, if a hip joint injection relieves your pain, it doesn't predict anything about whether the surgery is actually going to help you. This study completely undermines the assertion that a hip injection that relieves your hip pain means that you need surgery for hip impingement. Now, there are some surgery proponents who will say, hey, we don't just rely on hip injections for the diagnostic process. We have other tests that will help us determine whether or not somebody needs hip impingement surgery. They say that if you stack multiple tests, you improve the accuracy of your results, but this flies in the face of any logical assessment. As we've talked about in previous videos, the physical tests like Fader and Faber and all the other movement tests to determine whether or not somebody has some sort of deformity are total bunk. The false positive rates are through the roof, and there is no scientific evidence that the results relate to anything. X-ray and MRI results show no correlation with pain, range of motion difficulty, or any functional deficiencies. People who have these bad bone shapes can have really good range of motion or really bad range of motion. They may have some pain, they may have no pain. There is no correlation between what you find in the tests, on the x-rays, or when you do hip injections. A 2010 study that looked at multiple physical tests determined that all of them had very high false positive rates. And when you stack a bunch of tests with high false positive rates together, you end up with a 100% chance of getting a false positive. So if you take hip injections with an unknown false positive rate, but one that's likely very high, and you put them together with physical tests with a very high false positive rate, and then you put those next to some x-ray or MRI images that look very convincing because these things look very bad, you have a strong sounding pseudoscientific argument that somebody needs hip surgery. And at the end of all this, you have multiple studies showing the satisfaction rates for pain relief for surgery for hip impingement is really bad. Multiple randomized controlled trials show very limited improvement following hip impingement surgery, and the one trial that followed patients for 2 years determined that there was basically no difference between getting the surgery and not getting the surgery. And a recent Australian study showed that 30% of patients who underwent hip impingement surgery had signs of worsening hip cartilage after the surgery, whereas the patients who did not get hip surgery had no sign of hip cartilage worsening. Which is why I encourage you to ATM, always think muscles. If you have a movement problem, you need to address muscles because muscles are what move bone. Bony McBonerson here can't do much of anything on his own because he's got no muscles. If you have range of motion issues with your hip joints, you need to retrain the muscles to be able to move the bones correctly in relationship to one another. Muscles themselves can hurt, and the muscles can also create painful pinching sensations if they are putting your body parts into the wrong position. By training strength and flexibility in all the muscles that surround your hip joint, you'll be able to restore function and comfort. Your best bet to make progress is to find somebody locally who can work with you in person to help you troubleshoot your hips. find a trainer, find a physical therapist, find some sort of movement professional who doesn't buy into this idea that the bone shapes are the problem. The process takes time, it can be frustrating, you will make mistakes, but ultimately, the only thing that is going to help you move better is to have better control of your muscles. If you can't find somebody near you, I encourage you to go to my website at uprighthealth.com/DIY and find a hip program that'll help you rebuild the function of your hips. For more free videos to help you with your hip pain, be sure to check these out here. I'll also put more resources and research links in the description box. To support this channel, use the donate link you'll find in the description box or the join and thanks buttons on YouTube. Like, share, and subscribe with the bell notification on. And as always, I hope you remember that pain sucks. Life should.